Glad to be in church today.
Yes.
One more question. Are you ready for the word?
Yes.
Hey, look, here's the deal. I know it's beautiful outside. It's shiny. It's 70 degrees. But you're the faithful few who made it into church. So welcome. Welcome to church. I'm excited about today. We're in a series in the Gospel of Mark. We've been in the Gospel of Mark ever since we launched this church about 15 weeks ago. 15 weeks we launched this church. And we have seen, catch this, we've seen over 60 people make a decision for Jesus in the amount of time we've been in church. Thank God, all the glory, all the glory of God, absolutely, yes, yes, yes. So we're in the series in the Gospel of Mark, and I'd invite you, if you got a Bible, open it up to the Gospel of Mark, chapter number 4. We've made it to the fourth chapter of Mark in our 15 weeks here. We're going to be looking at the first 20 verses. It's a kind of a lengthy passage today, but the Gospel of Mark, chapter 4, the first 20 verses. I got a question for you. Have you ever just had one of those moments, one of those weeks maybe, or maybe just bring it down to a moment where, you know, you were reminded of just how terrible of a person you actually are? Have you ever had one of those moments? All right, I'm gonna get super real quick. All right, so Monday, man, this week was an awful week weather-wise, right? We had rain all week long. It was terrible. I felt terrible for Jason, the FedEx driver over here. It was just a bad week. So normally, I ride my bike everywhere I go around. So I try not to drive. It just frustrates me here in the city. So I ride my bike everywhere, but it was raining all week. So it forced me to have to take CTA. All right, now how many regular CTAers do we have in the room? We got this regular CTA. I only take CTA if I have to take CTA. So I take CTA one day, all right, and I'm going into Uptown. My day is done. I'm coming back home, and I am at Broadway in Lawrence, crossing the street heading north, all right? And I'm waiting for my little, you know, pop-up guy to tell me I can walk across the street, all right? I get my pop-up guy, tells me I can walk across the street. Mind you, it's raining, right? So I got my umbrella, got my backpack. I'm ready to go home. It's been a long, hard day, right? Saving people all day long, right? I'm ready to go home. And I'm at the crosswalk, and the little guy pops up, and I'm walking across the street, right? Got my umbrella, got my backpack in hand, and all of a sudden, this Dodge Charger. Mind you, I got the walk sign. I can walk, because the guy tells me I can walk. This Dodge Charger comes flying around, and almost hits me. Almost hits me. I can touch his car. I grab my umbrella. I'm not lying to you. I grab my umbrella in my hand, and I literally shoop, poof, right on his Dodge Charger. Dude, don't clap in this. The dude, I'm covered by God's grace, because the dude, the windows were tinted. I don't know if it's a guy or girl. Slams on his brakes, and I'm like, all right, now we're in Uptown, so things about to get real here, real quick, right? So.
Yeah, we should go, right?
So either they're stopped, they're going to shoot me, or we're going to get in a fight. One of the two happens. But luckily, to my advantage, there were four of Chicago's finest pulled over to the side. Already had a car pulled over with all their lights on. So this dude, or girl, I don't know, slams on their brakes. They're looking back at me. I'm looking at them trying to figure out what they're going to do. I'm watching the cops up ahead watching this entire thing unfold. This person in the Dodge Charger slams on his brakes, sits there for 10 seconds. I'm standing in the middle of the crosswalk just waiting to see what happens, right? He's just sitting there, or she is just sitting there, and we're watching both of the cops, or all four of the cops up here. Luckily, thank the good Lord, this person decides to like peel off and keep going, right? So like totally just saved by, we'll just call it God's grace, even though I right on this guy's dirty girl's charger, I have no idea. But I'm reminded, how many were reminded, right? That was a moment in my life. A moment where I'm just reminded really of how terrible of a person I am. Innately about me, there's like nothing good about me. Nothing good about me except for Christ living inside of me. You ever have one of those moments where you're just reminded of like how terrible of a person you actually are? Well, that's kind of what we have when we come to Mark chapter number 4. We're dealing with an issue of the heart, all right? Matters of the heart. And I've entitled this talk, How's Your Heart? Would you just turn to your neighbor? Turn to your neighbor. If you don't got a neighbor, you can say it to me. Turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor.
Neighbor.
Come on, talk to your neighbor. Say, neighbor.
Neighbor.
How's your heart?
How's your heart?
Turn to your other neighbor. Say, other neighbor. Other neighbor. How is your heart?
How's your heart?
It's no wonder in our country the medical profession has become obsessed with an issue of the heart, right? Because in America, the leading cause of death in our country is not drugs, it's not anything except for heart disease. That is the number one leading cause of death in our society, in our country today. The medical profession has gone crazy with this, right? Making sure our heart is healthy. And how much more so should it be the case with our spiritual condition, right? That's what Jesus is talking about all today in this passage. How is your heart? Mark chapter number 1, we'll pick it up in verse number 1. Let me just make a quick note here as we come to this. Mark, you remember this. Mark, I love Mark. He's ADD, right? He's the one thing to another, just bouncing around from topic to topic. He never stays on one topic long enough until we come to this passage right here. This is only one of two of the longer teachings that he records of Jesus, which lets us know one thing. This is important. If we don't get this, we're not going to get anything else. We got to make sure that we dive in and we understand what Jesus is about to say, what Mark is recording for us. Chapter number 4, verse 1. You there, say, I'm there.
I'm there.
Say it with a southern accent. Say, I'm there.
I'm there.
Yeah, here we go. Verse 1. Again, he began to teach beside the sea. This is Jesus. We're talking about the Sea of Galilee. All right, so remember last week, Jesus goes, he picks his 12 disciples, and then he goes home. But there was a demon-oppressed man who Jesus healed, and all of a sudden, there's this crowd that gathers around the house so that they could not even eat. So there's a crowd gathering around. Jesus heals a guy, and everybody kind of goes away. So Jesus takes this crowd to the Sea of Galilee. Look at it. And a very large crowd gathered about him so that he got into a boat and sat in it on the sea. And the whole crowd was beside the sea on the land. Now, I brought a map here so we can actually kind of visualize what's going on here at the Sea of Galilee. So this is the Sea of Galilee here. It is not a very large body of water by any means. This is probably only 10 miles from point to point and about 6 miles wide at its widest spot. So you can really stand on the shore and see the entire body of water. So what we need to understand about this particular body of water is everything you see that is not water was really kind of like based on a hill or on a mountain. In fact, you can read in other parts of the Bible where that like winds would come rushing over the hillside or the mountaintops of the Sea of Galilee, come rushing down onto the Sea of Galilee and cause these crazy storms, right? Like Matthew, I think it's 13 or chapter 14, where this big storm happens, right? And then Jesus, he sends his disciples out, and then he comes walking on the water like a ghost. Well, that's what happened. Like the wind comes rushing over the hillside, the mountaintops, right? All of these hillsides, and it comes rushing down on the Sea of Galilee and would cause these crazy, massive storms. But what also happened was this. So Jesus takes this large crowd. He, at some point, some part of the body of water, he pushes out to sea, and what you would have is a natural amphitheater, right? So, like, you have a massive crowd. How are you going to talk to them? They don't have microphones, right? That back in the day. So how is he going to talk to this entire crowd? He gets into a boat. He pushes out a little bit so that now what you have now is this natural amphitheater with all this crowd going around. So that's what we have going on here. A large crowd gathered about him so that he got into a boat. He sat in it on the sea, and the whole crowd was beside him on the sea. Verse number 2. And he was teaching them many things. Everybody say, many things.
Many.
He was teaching them many things in parables. You say, what's a parable? A parable was simply this. A parable was like an analogy, a story about familiar things that people would understand. Like preachers today, we do it all the time. We use like pop culture, we'll use, you know, who's hottest in, you know, entertainment today to like try to drive home a point. Well, that's what Jesus would often do. But this is like a massive shift in Jesus' ministry. We got to catch this today because this is a massive shift and what Jesus has already been doing. He came onto the scene, and Jesus was notorious for being in your face, all up in your grill, all up, hey, don't do that. You heard it said this, but I say this. Stop sinning. Stop committing adultery. Don't do this. Go do that. And it's all in your face, and it causes like an immediate response, right? It calls for an immediate action. And all of a sudden, Jesus changes. He's no longer in your face. He's no longer saying, stop it. He's no longer saying, stop sinning. Now all of a sudden, he's talking in parables and in these analogies. And you got to ask the question, why? Why all of a sudden was Jesus gangster one minute, right? He's all up in your grill. And then the very next moment, he's now talking in like these analogies and these parables and these mystic things that people have got to figure out why all of a sudden. I believe there's many reasons why, but I believe one of the main reasons is because Jesus, at this point, his popularity has grown so much, right? He's come onto the scene. He's about halfway through his public ministry at this point in his life, right? So he's come onto the scene. His popularity is growing so much so that the opposition to Jesus is also growing. So we've got scribes, we've got Pharisees that are all opposing Jesus all at one time. And now his disciples to come to him and they say, Jesus, why all of a sudden are you changing from direct in your face, in our face, to now these parables? He asked them. In fact, let's go to Matthew chapter 13. You don't have to turn it, but we'll get it up on the screen here. Matthew 13, his disciples came and asked him. Look at it. Even his disciples were like, Jesus, what is going on? You were in my face. You were causing me to like really question my life, and now all of a sudden you've changed. And they said, why do you use parables when you talk to the people? And then he replied, you are permitted to understand the secrets of the kingdom of heaven, but others are not. To those who listen to my teaching, more understanding will be given, and they will have an abundance of knowledge. But for those who are not listening, even what little understanding they have will be taken away from them. That is why I use these parables. For they look, but they don't really see. They hear, but they don't really understand. Let's keep on going to the next slide there. This fulfills the prophecy of Isaiah that says, when you hear what I say, you will not understand. When you see what I do, you will not comprehend. For the hearts of these people are hardened, and their ears cannot hear, and their eyes are closed. So their eyes cannot see, and their ears cannot hear, and their hearts cannot understand. And they cannot turn to me and let me heal them. But blessed are your eyes because they see, and your ears because they hear. This is interesting to me because what Jesus is saying is this: to whom much is given, much is required, right? So there's this idea, like there's a blessing that falls upon those who hear the parable and understand the parable. Because here's how a parable worked. Jesus would do this. He would throw out this analogy, and often in those days, and we're going to see this today, in those days, he used like agriculture, farming as an example. Today we may use pop culture, but back in that day, it was an agricultural society. So he's going to use like this agricultural analogy for people to understand. And the way it worked is he would throw out the analogy, and then it would kind of be like real mysterious, real mystic, and you don't really know what it means. But if you wanted to know what it meant, all you had to do was ask Jesus. Jesus, what does that mean? And we'll see that today in our parable. But if you didn't want to know, you were then not accountable for it. There's a blessing to those who heard it and understood it. But can I suggest to you that there's also, this is a gracious act of our Heavenly Father. Because if you never understood it, you were then not accountable for it. You're then not accountable to God for the knowledge that you don't understand, you don't have. Right? And here's just to kind of prove that a little further. In James chapter 3, it says, let not many become teachers, because they're held to a higher standard. Right? They're held to a higher, like if I'm up here preaching the Word of God, that means I should be competent enough in the Word of God to not only teach it, to not only tell you what it says, but also to what? To live by it. Right? So like, this is a gracious act of our Heavenly Father. There's a blessing on those who hear the parable and understand the parable. But there's also a gracious act going on that if you don't understand the parable, you're not accountable for it. This is a gracious act on our Heavenly Father's part. All that said, we're going to dive into the parable. You ready?
Yeah.
Ready. Here's kind of the premise. We're gonna get into it here. Verse number 3 says this. And in his teaching, he said to them, listen. Everybody say, listen.
Listen.
Behold, a sower went out to sow. We're in urban America here. We don't have to go very far outside the city to, like, we know that Illinois is covered in cornfields and in bean fields. And we understand to a degree the idea of sowing and reaping a harvest. But in urban America, we don't really understand that too much here. But the sower goes out to sow. And he sowed, and as he sowed, some seed fell along the path. Now here's, as we dive into this, let me just give you a brief understanding here. What we're talking about is really the Word of God. The sower going out to sow the seed. The seed represents the Word of God. As we kind of throw it out there, as we throw it along and we sow that seed, it's representing the Word of God. And the entire premise of this parable is based upon the fact, based on, predicated upon this idea. How are you going to respond to the Word of God? How am I going to respond to the Word of God that is sown in me? So he says, listen, behold, a sower went out to sow. And as he sowed, some seed fell along the path. This is funny because in Israel, the land of Israel, people make jokes about it, right? People, they'll say when God made Israel, he kind of made a mistake because he dropped all of the rocks on Israel. It's such a rocky land, such a rocky terrain there. So some fell, and as he sowed, some fell along the path. So what you would have is this. You'd have like a sower going out along like a walking path, which would be covered in rocks. But the idea is he's throwing seed out. Some seed may fall on rocks. Some seed along the path, you're going to have a ton of rocks. They weren't able to like actually excavate all the rocks out of the path. But some seed would fall along like an area where it'd be a little bit more depth. There'd be more depth to the soil to where that seed could actually get down in there. And then it says this, and the birds came and devoured it. And other seed fell on rocky ground where it didn't have much soil. And immediately it sprang up since it had no depth of soil. And when the sun rose, it scorched, and since it had no root, it withered away. Other seed fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked it, and it yielded no grain. And other seeds fell into good soil, and it produced grain, growing up, increasing, and yielding 30-fold, 60-fold, and 100-fold. Can I just make one quick observation here? The sower, so let's just say it's you or me, right? It's a believer in Jesus Christ. We got our bag on with all of our seed on. You grab your seed out, and you're just sowing seed. You're just throwing seed out. Can you notice this about the sower? Would you notice this about this particular story? He makes no regard for what kind of soil he's throwing that seed into. He's just throwing seed out. Right, he's just going along the path. He's going along the rocky terrain. He's going into the thorns, and he's just throwing seed out. He doesn't care what the soil is like. All he's doing is throwing seed out. He's just throwing it out there, making sure it's getting anywhere and everywhere that sower goes. He doesn't care what kind of ground he's on. He doesn't care if he's on a boulder. He's throwing it out there because he is sowing the seed. It's so funny because in the church, we get so caught up in like the exterior, right? We're like, you know, you got your seed out, right? You're ready to go sow some seed. You're ready to be a good example. You're ready to go be a light for Jesus in your workplace or wherever. And then you're met with like somebody who maybe is a little bit, I don't know, hard-hearted. And then we make a judgment right away. We're like, nah, they wouldn't want to hear what I have to say. So I'm just gonna drop a little. God bless you, right? Left my seed. There it is, right there, right? Or that person, they're too shallow, right? They wouldn't understand God bless you or hey, they wouldn't understand Christian talk, or they wouldn't understand the things of the Bible. So I'm just going to say, Merry Christmas, right? Because Christ is in the word Christmas, and there's my seed. I dropped it in their life. Or that person, they're too busy. They don't have time for what I have to say, right? They're just too busy. They got too much going on, and I'm not even going to bother with them because they're way too busy anyway. Or the vocabulary says, I don't believe in God. Or the vocabulary says, I want nothing to do with church or the Word of God. I want nothing to do with you. You Christian, don't be put off by that. Just sow the seed. Just throw the seed out. Just get it out there. The hard heart, you may be met by that. You may be met by that person. But don't judge that person based upon the exterior. You're going to be met by a second person too, and that's the shallow heart, verse 16. And they're the ones sown on rocky ground. The ones who, when they hear the word of God, immediately receive it with joy. and when and they have no root in themselves, but endure it for a while. Then, when tribulation or persecution arises on account of the word, immediately they fall away. So here's this person. They walk into church. They're excited. They're ready to go. They hear the word of God. We give an altar call. They raise their hand. They say, that's for me. I want Jesus. I'm all in. I want to receive what Jesus has for me. I raise my hand. I pray the prayer. I text in whatnot to 555-888. I'm ready to go. This is all good. I'm ready. I'm in. Let's go. And then immediately they leave. And right, like their kids start cussing at them, or something happens in their life, persecution arises, some kind of tribulation, or they get distracted, and all of a sudden they've been coming to church for a month. They're like, every week, they're right there, every week, right there, every week, and then something happens, and then they're gone. Why? Well, look at it. There's no root. There's no root in their life. They were excited about it. This is a sobering thought for you and for I. Because there comes a point in someone's life when you can sense the presence of Jesus, but never know Jesus. Can I caution you that perhaps maybe you're here today and you would say, you know what, maybe that's me. Maybe I'm the shallow heart. Maybe I fell on the rocky ground. That word of God came in. I was excited about it. I was all in. I was ready to go. I was excited about my newfound faith, but it never took root in my life. I sensed the presence of God, but I never responded to the presence of God. It never took a root in my life. And can I just caution you, if that's you today, don't mistake the presence of God, being able to sense the presence of God, with actually knowing God. The shallow heart never took root. If there's no root, it will not bear fruit. There's a third heart, and that's, we'll just call this one the busy heart. Verse 18. And others are the ones sown among the thorns. They are those who hear the word, but the cares of the world and the deceitfulness of riches and the desires for other things enter and choke the word, and it proves unfruitful. So this person, they hear the word. You're out there, you're throwing the seed. You're out there, you give the seed, you sow the word of God in their life, and they say, yeah, cool, awesome. I got 10,000 other things on my list. I'm going to add Jesus to it just because I don't have a religion thing on my to-do list yet. So I'm going to add that to my list of things that I can do. It's cool. Totally fine. That's cool. I'm just going to add it to my list. But this person is so busy. This person receives the word because they can just add it to their list of things to do. But there is no priority of Jesus in their life. So immediately the cares of the world, the deceit of riches, going after their career, going after whatever in their life, going after that thing, that whatever it may be, it chokes out the word of God in their life. And it's no longer a priority in their life. And again, we have to be very, very cautious that as we are saying these are the four kinds of people we're going to be met with, we have to ask ourselves, God, is that me? Is that me in my life? Jesus, are you a priority in my life? Or am I just kind of like the busy heart? Am I the person who's received the word of God? I'm really passionate about the word of God, but the reality is this. At no point in my life is Jesus a priority. I'm not in the word. I'm not daily communing with God. There's nothing in my life that points to the fact that Jesus is number one in my life. You have to ask yourself that question. I have to ask myself that question. God, are you the priority of my life above everything, above everyone? But as you're out, you're sowing the seed, you're going to be met by that person. You're going to be met by the busy heart. And there's a fourth heart. The fourth one is this, simply, and we'll just call it what the Bible calls it, the good heart. This person's ready for the word. This person is ready to receive. This person is ready. The soil is so rich for this person to receive the seed and for it to grow. Look at it, verse 20. But those who were sown on the good soil are the ones who hear the word and they accept it and they bear fruit. Look at this. 30-fold, 60-fold, 100-fold. In those days, a good harvest, if you sow seed and you reap a harvest, a good harvest in those days was 5-fold. Like an above average was 7-fold. An incredible harvest was 10-fold. Jesus says, look at it. Look at it. 30-fold, 60-fold, 100-fold. The proof is in the fruit. The proof is in the fruit of your life. And as you look at your life, as you're out throwing the seed, as you're out there, the proof is in the fruit of their life. And again, you have to ask yourself that question. God, is there fruit in my life? Is there fruit in my marriage? Is my marriage healthy? Is there fruit in my kids? Do my kids love Jesus? Do my kids love me? Are my kids an example? Is there fruit in your life? The good heart. The heart is ready to receive. My question for you simply is this today. What kind of soil is your heart? What kind of soil do you have inside of you? Are you the one that perhaps it's the seed is thrown, right? It falls onto the path, right? You're kind of hard and callous to the things of God. You're not really sure. You're kind of put off by the whole thing. Maybe you're the shallow heart. You receive the word of God, but it never takes root. Maybe you're the busy heart. Maybe you're the good heart. What kind of soil is your heart? And all I can tell you is this: where there is no fruit, there is no root in your life. And if wherever you fall in your journey with God, wherever it is that you're at, whatever kind of soil is your heart, it's not too late to change it. God has a plan for your life. He who has ears, Jesus says, he who has ears, let him hear. God wants to do a significant work in your life. Would you bow your heads with me and let's pray together today.